Good morning. Welcome. We made it through another week. Another perilous week.
Praise the Lord.
So much things, so many things happening. It's hard to keep track of them. But God has blessed us with another week. He brought us safely through as he has throughout all of our lives. And we should be grateful for that. Then let's give him a little tribute here. Our Father and our God, we want to thank you, Father, for bringing us safely this far. Father, for allowing us to operate during these perilous times, Father. We just ask that you give us wisdom, Father, so that we don't make silly and stupid mistakes, Father, as we try to deal with this pandemic, that we don't listen to silly and stupid people, Father, who tell us to do things that we know is not right, Father. So we just ask for a hedge of protection around us, Father, because all that instruction comes from on high, Father, it's from president on down, Father. And some of our brothers and sisters will be caught up in that, Father. We ask for protection from that, Father, as we know the things that are going on in this world, Father. People get caught up in them to their detriment, Father. And we just want you to bless the family of Mr. Kane, passed away from the virus, Father. But we ask that you provide wisdom so others don't make the same mistakes that he made, which has resulted in him passing. So, Father, bless those who made their way here. Bless those who are on their way, Father. Bless the word and the instruction and that will be coming forth regarding the book of Revelation. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, let's go right into our stand in the gap moment. Stand in the Gap, as most of you know, is a Stand in the Gap USA is our Christian education forum, excuse me, where we try to teach people and educate them on where God is and God's Word, and that we should be drawing closer to Him as opposed to moving away from Him, which creates the gap. And God asks for us to stand in that gap, to bring the people closer back to him, give them knowledge. Because he says our people die because of lack of knowledge. And so that's what we're about. And there are going to be some positions that we take, and we take positions based on the Bible knowledge. And some of you may not like those, but don't get mad at me, because I'll just be saying what God says. Now, I call this standing gap moment because, as I said in the beginning, so much is happening in this world today that there are certain moments that are created whereby we need somebody to stand in the gap. And once again, as we move through this pandemic and as we move through through the civil rights crisis that we're in, we need to understand the moment. Now, I've gone to this passage of scripture on several occasions. Micah 6:8. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And I want to focus on the act justly, because that's nothing more than justice for people, that we must act with justice for people. And so this is what God has set forth for us, and he says that is good, and this is what he requires of us. And so we need to understand where we've been in our study of Revelation. You know, we talked about the Great Babylon, which is basically the world system that has developed since the Tower of Babel. And every great nation that has come along after that has adopted this world system. And this world system is not leaning toward justice, as you know. You have a few who have all the power and have all the resources, and the multitude do not, and those who are different are even set off on a lower level than that, and there's no way in that system that they're able to work their way through it. Now, I know some people will say, yeah, some people are able to work their way up and all that through the system and benefit from that, but the vast majority do not. And even those who think they've worked their way up through the system, as my wife and I were talking, is that you're in a box. The system has created a box, and you live in that box. Now, you may be able to rise to the top in that box, and even if you break through that box, you find out you're in another box. And so the system is keeping you in a certain situation. And it we talked about one time that all that is the matrix that's been pulled down over your eyes and making you think that this is real and reality, and this is the way it's supposed to be. Well it's not. Now, what I want to focus on in this stand the gap moment is voting. The reason I want to focus on voting is because there are attacks that are going on our voting as it is allowed right now. As we know, we have a pandemic, and there's an effort to make sure that we have more mail-in voting for those that don't want to come out into a pandemic because they're in a risk category, or they're afraid that they'll get it anyway because people out there are not wearing masks or not distancing and all that. So one of the ways that you can get around that is mail-in voting. And mail-in voting is nothing new. Absentee voting has been around for a while. And no matter what people say, there's no difference between absentee voting and mail-in voting. It's the same thing for different reasons. Now, our president is attacking mail-in voting and for his own political purposes. And it's no different than what has happened throughout America about voting. You see, John Lewis, C.T. Vivian, all of them fought for us to have a right to vote. And civil rights movement a lot was focused to a large extent on the right to vote. And what has happened throughout that time and even prior to that is a concept called voter suppression. And so I thought, maybe where does the right to vote come from in our country? Because we say it's the Constitution allows me the right to vote. Well, in the original Constitution it did not.
it was basically silent about it. The right to vote actually came from the amendments. And a lot of those came after slavery was abolished, and then through civil rights movements throughout the time. So and the amendments basically said that you can't deny the right to vote based upon race and color and on the prior condition of servitude, of course, sex and age, but all other reasons for allowing voting are left up to the states. So that's why you have different states coming up with different laws or as to who can vote and who cannot vote. And you say, okay, that's fine. No, it's not fine, because they've used that politically to limit your people's right to vote. How they do it? Have you ever heard of gerrymandering? Redistricting? At-large districts, single-member districts, and all that kind of thing? All is a way to dilute your vote. Some say that you have to pass a test in order to vote. And Barack Obama at the funeral of John Lewis said, we no longer have to guess how many jelly beans are in the jar. That's just blatant and outright. But they've done it in different ways. Like they will say that, especially in Cincinnati, for example, the way they restricted your power, the power of your vote, is that your urban district, where most of your blacks would live, if you ran for office, you have to run throughout the entire county. And the rest of the county, other than in the city, is white, but you have to run in out there too. And it's already stacked with white. And for the longest time, no blacks could ever be elected to an office. Then they would district it so where you have to run through all these districts, and most of them are white. So they kept you down, and you weren't able to exercise your franchise. But so we talked about the Great Babylon, the world system, and how the world system is basically a sinful system that doesn't act under Micah 6:8 justly. And so one other quick example. Back in maybe the 40s or the 50s or whatever, the government passed housing legislation. And basically what they did was they allowed these developers to develop outside of the city in what we now call suburbs. And in the with the loans that they would offer to them and the deeds that they would issue, they actually had in there that you can't transfer this property to black people. You say, what? Oh yeah. Now, they can't enforce that anymore, but the damage was done, because they were able to get that land. They were able to get that subdivision out in the suburbs. Excuse me. And then they would pass it on to their kids. So it's established. And blacks can't really make a way out into that. That's the plan. Now, what has happened is, of course, blacks may start moving out there, but then legislation was made and that would allow low-cost housing to be put out into the suburbs. Although President Trump recently said that we're not going to allow you low-cost housing out in our beautiful suburbs. And the low-cost housing is an effort to try to keep that housing away from black people. No doubt about it. Say low income too, but mainly black people they're trying to keep it away from. And so he wants to make sure that is remains that way. Your beautiful suburbs will remain the way they are. Now, you say, okay, well, that's what Constitution says. I said, it does. But you say, what does God require? Does the Bible say anything about voting? Well, no, it doesn't. Specifically. Oh, but yes, it does. You say, but I can go through that Bible. I can find, I don't see anything about voting. What you see is Micah 6:8. That's what you see. You see, God specifically says that you have to act justly, with justice. He didn't put any specifics in there though. That's right, because he said, in everything you do, act justly. And so, if he put specifics in there, people find ways to get around it and all that. But he didn't. He said, everything you do, act justly. Now, God says, no limits on it. Even if you can't read. Even if you are convicted of a felony, they'll try to cut your vote off. And you say, well, if you got convicted of a felony, then maybe you shouldn't have the right to vote. Well, what if I get convicted of a felony? I do my time, I come out, and I follow all the rules of parole and all that kind of thing. Why can't I vote? I'm not even sure you should be able to allow people not to vote even if they're in jail, to be truthful. You say, well, they lost their right. But every time there's an opportunity, there's a reason now to say, you can't vote. You can't vote because you're not 21. You can't vote because you don't have the mindset to do it. You don't know what you're doing. And whatever reason they have for doing it, you're still controlled by Micah 6:8 to act justly. To act justly. And understand that you act justly is a requirement of the Bible, and you'll be judged on that. You say, well, wait a minute. I'm going to get judged on the fact that I didn't allow some people to vote. Yes, you will be. Why? Because you violated Micah 6:8. You didn't act justly with your fellow man. Now, yep. And what's that mean? That means, yep. You'll be judged on it, Bull Connor. You'll be judged on it, George Wallace. You'll be judged on it, Andrew Jackson, Woodrow Wilson, David Duke, and Donald Trump. You will be judged on it.
Don't forget those different state houses too, the gerrymander and redistrict. Don't forget them, add them in too.
Well, they're in it because that act justly covers them too. And in their efforts to try to keep people from voting, they are going to be judged on that also. And let me tell you, you know, this little thing I saw too that Mr. Trump is doing in order to suppress mail-in voting is he has put somebody in charge of the post office or
his friend.
Yeah.
And crony.
And so hamstringing the post office effort to even handle an influx of mail-in voting. Whew. Boy, that Great Babylon is something else. But remember, God has not changed. He's not changed. America keeps moving away. Keeps moving away. And the gap is widening. So where are our John Lewis's? Where are our C.T. Vivian's, Reverend Abernathy's, Martin Luther King, Reverend Lowry's? They're passing away. Some have already passed and some have just passed. And if there are any of them left, they're going to be passing away. So, and they stood in the gap. No doubt about it. They stood in the gap for justice. And God is looking for that next generation of those with the courage to stand in the gap. Stand in the gap for what is required by Micah 6:8.
States voting without hurting the rights of all other citizens. Democracy is built on this. This is why every man has the right to vote, regardless. Is what I'm saying true? Yeah. Is it what you think and what you believe? Yeah. Go back. We're all ready to arrest us. We're willing to be beaten for democracy. You beat people free in order that they will not have the privilege to vote.
So what does the Lord ask of you? What does he require of you but to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God? People ought to take that Micah 6:8 to heart and keep that in mind when they make their decisions on how they treat people in whatever you do. Alrighty. And you know the reason why? You know the reason why? Even if it's that you may not want to do it, the reason why is because Judgment Day is coming.